just like my favorite song going round, round my head. You're listening to the Off the Hosel podcast presented by Rollo Golf. Your hosts are Drew Koser, Troy Koser, Tori Coughlin, and Turner Riplinger. Reminder, presented by Rollo Golf, TaylorMade affiliated. Now sit back and enjoy the podcast. Rollo Golf, presenting sponsor of the Off the Hosel podcast. Reminder, at checkout on all orders, Hosel 25. H-O-S-E-L 25, promo code for 25% off on all orders. Check out Rollo Golf today.
All righty, we're pleased to have back on the podcast for the third time our Sasky buddy, Darren Dreger. Dregsy, thanks for coming back to the podcast today, man. How's things?
Things are good. You know, I'm here in Ontario, and I'm looking around at what I'm seeing here, and I have the advantage of looking at all the screens, and I see all you guys at varying places in your worlds, and I'm like, I guess it's okay, but I like where I'm sitting at better than where you guys are. Or you've got to do some home improvements to get the backdrops cleaned up here a little bit.
You know, that's
what you don't like that script, eh? Hey,
you know what, Dregsy? That's twice now you've done that. Because actually, the first time time came on, you grilled my old place in Regina. Now I'm living in Estevan, coaching with the Bruins. And I had, remember Troy had just the backdrop, it was just a straight white wall. And he's like, I like Turner's backdrop, but Drew, you look like you're in a dungeon or a cell. So, I have a mannequin back there. I have our hats back here. We're grinding. But your backdrop's unbelievable. If you're watching on YouTube, Dreggy's, his backdrop's unreal. So anyhow, we're already into one chirp. So thanks for that, Dregs.
No problem.
How's things?
Summer's good. As you probably know, like I was born and raised in Saskatchewan, and then we bought a lake property on the Manitoba side, a Lake of the Prairies. And I think I explained this in the past, so yep. I won't want to go over it too much, but the reason was sunsets in the west, that's what we want to look at. But we had another terrific year there. The walleye were biting, maybe not quite as aggressive as they were last summer. Played a lot of golf, drank a few beverages with all my buddies, saw the people I needed to see, and then got back here and into Ontario, so all good.
So, Darren, quickly, Tori, before you jump in, how far are you from Estevan?
How far away is Estevan from Yorkton?
Three.
3 hours?
Three beers.
Yeah, so I got to be, two. I was thinking more like five or six, but I would say, we're probably in the... we'd be three and a bit, maybe.
Well, let's link up next summer, play some golf. We're close.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I don't think so, but keep going. Yeah, maybe.
Just roasted you. By the way, Darren, the script A, you can't hate that.
No.
That rate there, that's my wife playing college volleyball. That rate there is when I won the state down here. So I don't know why you're complaining about my backdrop.
Alabama?
Yeah.
I like it.
I can't believe you didn't
a nice little wall.
Just kidding. Yeah. At the end of that, I'm disappointed. Anyways.
What did you say? You can't believe what?
Like, I can't believe Darren didn't say just kidding at the end of the whole chirp there. Now I just got bodied on live on podcast.
No, he wasn't joking.
No, I wasn't. Like, no, that's impressive. I'm not going to lie. I like it. I can't chirp that.
Okay. Let's get right into the NHL discussion today, Greg. We're going to go through all the Canadian teams, if you're okay with that. We're going to start with, obviously, Montreal, Ottawa, Calgary, Winnipeg, Toronto, Vancouver, Edmonton. But first, the Canadians, Line A hurt. I've been watching the rebuild doc on Crave. Where are
pretty
you
good.
With that? Yeah, it is really good. Where are you at with the Canadians? Are they gonna, push the needle? Are they keep them going, or are they just
yeah? Well, Well, you know what? I'm a sucker for a good coach and good management. So I'm willing to give the benefit of the doubt here to Marty St. Louis and Ken Hughes and by extension, Jeff Gorton, because, and then look, again, I'm not sucking up to the Montreal Canadiens, but you know, ownership at some point has to take responsibility for things that aren't going the way that you want them to go. And that's really what Montreal ownership did. So they bring in a non-French speaking supervisor in Jeff Gorton, and he goes, okay, well, here's what we need to do. You know, Ken Hughes is bilingual, had a wealth of experience on the agent side. So he's got that wealth of knowledge. Well, one of the first guys he leans on is Marty St. Louis, who happens to be a Hall of Famer, who has no coaching experience outside of minor hockey. But he's like, nah, you know what? This guy has been around winning teams. He knows how to build that culture, and he's come up the hard way. So all the pieces of that puzzle from ownership down have fit. And I loved what I heard from Marty St. Louis earlier this week when he talked about, hey, you know, you can build a house, but a house isn't a home unless you put the right people in it. That's what makes it a home. And we're all hockey people on this podcast, so we're suckers for that kind of stuff. And that includes me. But there also has to be a reality to all of this. And injuries aside, you know, there'll be no excuses to the Montreal Canadiens this year. I don't think they're going to be a playoff team. I think that's a little too lofty. But I do think that they're going to be beyond the 76-point mark, which, you know, some prognosticators have suggested. And if they can be, then that's a step towards the goal. Next year, 25-26, we're having a different conversation. Then the Canadians have to be a team that's at least in that playoff mix. But I think they still have a lot of growing pains here.
Boys, any chatter on the Canadians here before we jump on?
I hope they get 26 points this year. No, I'm kidding.
Okay. Well, no, if they do, people are going to get fired. There's no doubt about that.
But so you definitely believe in Marty St. Louis?
I do.
Because I think he's done a hell of a job. So
you should watch that Cray thing, dude. He's unbelievable. Like
really good.
It's really good. Yeah.
And then look, not to be an infomercial, but anytime you can pull the curtain back, in any sport, in this case, you know, in the National Hockey League and specific to the Montreal Canadiens, that's what you want to see. And look, Marty St. Louis, he's not trying to fool anybody. He's not there trying to make an impression or, you know, build a new career. This guy's a Hall of Famer. He's got lots of money. He was asked to come into a situation that, you know, he believed that he could fix, and he's very much in the fix. So anything you see in the background on the rebuild, which again, they've focused on that documentary, is exactly what Marty St. Louis is. They're just not there yet. I hope that there's enough patience in that market, more from the fan base than anything else, to allow St. Louis and that group to try and get the job done. Inevitably, there'll come a time, if they don't, where, all right, enough is enough. They're not anywhere near that yet. He's the guy for that job.
Totally not related to Montreal. I'm sorry. The biggest hockey podcast, they always talk about state tax, which I can relate to.
Yeah.
And obviously, taxes different in Canada.
Yeah.
Do you think that's hurting the Canadian teams?
No question about it. And not only Canadian teams, but a lot of teams in general. Like, you know, I mean, look, if you're making millions of dollars, who wouldn't want to live in Manhattan and play for the New York Rangers? I mean, if money isn't an option and you've got that lifestyle, of course, that's what you're going to want to do. But I wonder, and I don't know that it'll happen in the next collective bargaining agreement. And I know our podcast viewers and fans don't want to hear any of this, so I won't bog them down on all the minutia of what goes into a negotiation in the CBA. But it does feel like we're getting to a place where that taxation issue matters, because even in Alberta, like Leon Draisaitl just signed a contract extension. You hear that? I don't know if you heard the big dog bark. Tiny, my Great Dane, just turned 10 years old today. She just woofed.
Nice. Good show. Anyway. Hey, couple of clicks.
Yeah. So to go back to my lot here. You know, Draisaitl signs his extension in Edmonton. And I think I had somebody say to me to equate that, if we're using Mitch Marner as an example, who's going into the final year of his deal, for him to get the same money that Draisaitl is getting in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, he would have to make $15.5 million in Toronto, Ontario, Canada.
So, I was going to guess 16.
Yeah, I mean, that's a Canadian discrepancy, right? Let alone, you know, what you're dealing with when you're a free agent. You're, you know, if you're a mid-level, top level free agent, of course you're looking at all the tax-friendly states. Of course you are, before even looking in Canada, unless you're towards the end of your career and you still have bargaining power and you want to play closer to home or one of those situations. So that tax issue is a big one. There's no doubt.
So, Darren, you know, just for our listeners out there, I know the answer. Drew knows the answer. Or knows the answer. I know you know the answer. But for our listeners out there, teams like Edmonton, Calgary, Vancouver, Ottawa, Toronto, Montreal, blah, 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 their contracts, are they paid in U.S. dollars or Canadian dollars being north of the border?
Yeah, they're paid in U.S. dollars. And, you know, again, to some that wouldn't matter if you're living in Canada. Of course it is. I didn't check the currency today, but in Canadian dollars, what is it? Like $1.35, $1.37, something like that.
68 cents on the dollar today. Yeah.
I mean, you know, so you're talking about value there. There's no doubt about that. It doesn't, again, I'm not trying to defeat the point that I just made about why it's going to matter. Of course it matters. It matters when you're a top end guy. Or it matters if you're an end of the career guy, you're maybe going into your final contract, you've got a young family, you're looking for stability, and then that does matter in terms of where you want to live and all the taxes that go into that. But, you know, at the end of the day, okay, let's again use Draisaitl as an example. So in Alberta, they've got a slight advantage, which I've already articulated, and they get paid in US dollars. So, you know, chances are Edmonton, because of Draisaitl, because of McDavid, because of Hyman, because of all the pieces that they have, should be an easier draw now, given that they went to game 7 in the Stanley Cup final with all the business drawn into it, than they've been in a long, long time.
Okay. I love that. Speaking of stars, though, moving on to the Ottawa Senators. Tim Stutz, Brady Tkachuk, Thomas Chabot, all injured. My question is, and you hear all the rumors, they're in the playoffs. They're making the playoffs. Where are you at with the Ottawa Senators?
I'm a believer in the Ottawa Senators. I'm going to have to submit. You know, we do the season preview on TSN. I think it airs on Monday. And we all throw our lists of where the Canadian teams are going to finish in each division. And I'm struggling with Ottawa. I have them as high as 3 in the Atlantic. I might be overselling a little bit, but, you know, it feels like they've addressed their goaltending in Linus Ullmark. And if he can stay healthy, if he can be as good as we think he is, then I do think they have the horses to challenge for a playoff spot. And if they hit a run, as we've seen other teams do, and maybe they're capable of that. I like Travis Green as a coach. I like what Steve Staios did in getting certain pieces of his roster, all of that. The problem is when you make a projection of a team that's moving up, way up, and making a play, who's coming out of the playoffs, right?
Yeah.
And that's always the challenging part. So if you do a deeper dive into the Ottawa Senators, I really like what they did defensively. I like this Yakimchuk kid, man.
Oh, yeah, he's legit, dude.
He made a bad play initially last night on whatever goal it was. It's going to happen. And he's such a smart defenseman that, he's going to make that play 50 times in his NHL career. Over a long span of time, you're 100% right. You know, and then he made amends after the fact and, you know, he put points on the board and all of that. A week, 10 days ago, the media in Ottawa were talking about how he was going back to Calgary this week. And we're talking about this past week, right? We're into a new week, and he's still in the National Hockey League. And he's earned a right to an extended look. Ottawa has a history, most teams do, of not rushing their young NHL defense. So I think he'll go back to Calgary, and that'll be fine. But holy smokes, he's going to be – you know, he's playing top pairing with Jake Sanderson, who we had Mark Mathod on TSN last week.
Yeah.
Described him as arguably right now Ottawa's best player. Not best defenseman. Best player. So that speaks to where Yakubchuk and some of these other kids are coming from.
So quickly on the Senators, though, with Shabbat and Brady Tkachuk and Stützle now being out, not sure how long. I mean, you may know more. Do they come off to a slow start? You know, like, does that set them back a bit? Because those are three core guys. Yeah. The Shabbat plays 28 and a half a night. Like
none of that is supposed to be serious. I mean, that, like, you know, I had a call with somebody from Ottawa a couple of hours ago, and that's what they told me was that it's all, and you're at a point in the preseason, where the regular season is looming, and anyone with a bump or a bruise, and they all have that at this point of training camp. And we can get into that conversation about the preseason, the NHL being ridiculously long.
Oh, we're getting there.
Yeah, but no, I mean, those guys are, they seem to all be in good shape. It's about goaltending and just about everybody buying into what Travis Green is going to sell. And as hockey people, you guys know this, and you don't have to be in the National Hockey League, be a head coach in the NHL to understand this. If you don't look after your own in the defensive zone, you're just not going to have enough success, because the teams who are capable of outscoring their mistakes are few. They're few. And Green is preaching that. Craig Berube is preaching that in Toronto, and go down the list. So I like Ottawa. If I'm wrong, I'll admit I'm wrong at varying points of the regular season, but I think they're a playoff worthy team. I do.
Okay. Well, I'm gonna jump in here, Drewster. I'm gonna ask Darren this. We're talking Canadian teams. Who's the one Canadian team that you believe will be bottom? And why? Yeah, who's the one that's not going to make playoffs? Who's going to be the worst of the Canadian teams?
I mean, I think Calgary's in for a real tough year. For a variety of reasons. I mean, we know that, you know, Calgary's gone through some upheaval. I think that there's more to come there. So that's not a surprise. I don't think anybody's watching or listening. Beyond that, I think that Canada, for the most part, is on the upswing. I mentioned Ottawa and how I'm struggling to where I put them in the Atlantic. Equally, I'm struggling with the Vancouver Canucks in the Pacific. Like, Vancouver had a hell of a year last year. Yeah. Like, you know, terrific year.
Aren't they really struggling with goaltending, though, right now?
Well, they will be. I mean, if Thatcher Demko isn't 100% healthy and ready to roll, than goaltending, but you can say that about any team. For Vancouver, for sure, that's the biggest question mark. So I'm not prepared to say that I think they're going to take a step back. So right now I'm wrestling in the Pacific with, I've got Edmonton number one, and that's deserved, right? Like, come on. I mean, they went to game 7 in the Stanley Cup final. I think that Jeff Jackson beforehand, look at that, Look at that. That's impressive. Yeah, I like it. Stan Bowman is a hell of a GM. He's moved on. Everybody's moved on. So we can all move on. He's going to do good things for the Edmonton Oilers. I just feel that they're positioned better. So you might go 1-2 there. And then you look at the bottom of that division, and that's where I see the Calgary Flames.
I wanted to jump right in because you mentioned goalies earlier.
Yeah.
Step forward or status quo for the Calgary Flames, who have three goalies with Wolf and their Wolf. Anyhow, Calgary Flames, we want to know in or out, step forward or status quo or worse with that.
Worse. Well, worse. Not worse, but not because of the goaltending. So you're right. Like, what do they got? They've got Wolf, they've got Vladar.
Yeah. And
I mean
Mr. Siv.
Yeah, but their goaltending is,
I was reminiscing our younger days when they had the plastic Mr. Siv we used to hide.
Oh, yeah, Mr. Siv is what he said. I mean, goaltending is going to be questionable for sure. I mean, Dustin Wolf has been a terrific goaltender, you know, leading up to this point, certainly in the American League. So I'm not throwing him under the bus. You know, Dan Vladar has had his moments, but I mean, you move out Jacob Markstrom, come on. Like, you know, you're going backwards in that area. What about
Jonathan Huberdeau? Sorry to cut you off, Dredd, but like Jonathan Huberdeau, yeah, I think he had back-to-back 100-point seasons in Florida.
Yeah.
And now he's just another guy.
Yeah, well,
like,
that's...
When does he get off the schneid and he's scoring 100 points again and he's back and being the guy? Like, does that ever happen again, or does he have to get moved again, or is he too old? Like, Huberdeau was nasty.
Yeah. Yeah, and he also had Barkov beside him, and he had lots of pieces in Florida that he doesn't have. And I'm not building in an excuse, and Huberto is not looking for excuses. I mean, here's a guy who's owned it, right? Like, how many times has he stood in front of the cameras and admitted, I need to be better. I need to do this. I need to do that. Well, yeah, but you're paid millions of dollars, and that's what the Flames need. You know, if he doesn't step up and be the player that he can be offensively in every category that you want to describe, leadership, all that, Nazem Kadri, yeah, same thing. Go down the list. I mean, all we're going to talk about in my business as an insider is who's the first piece to fall there. Is it Michael Backlund because he's on a shorter contract? Is it Nazem Kadri because he's on a long term, but it's...
He's
an affordable deal, and he's a hell of a hockey player that other teams will make room for. How do you move Huberto? I mean, all of that stuff is fair game if these guys don't hit the ground running from the start of the regular season. So if they don't, that's what we're going to be dealing with all year.
Well, Drags, I think I got the inside information for you and the show. It's none of those guys you just mentioned out of Calgary. You know what it is. It's Harvey the Hound. You got to get rid of him now.
Like Craig McTavish did.
I wasn't even aware that Harvey that was still around, with all due respect. So that's a good scoop.
we're getting closer to Troy and Torrey's teams, but quickly here, and I literally wrote down in my notes, where are they? I feel like they're stuck. ... The Winnipeg Jets.
I understand why you feel like they're stuck. And I think the fans feel like that too, right? But I'm not so sure. They have the key elements, the foundation of what it takes to win. And it starts with a goalie in Connor Hellebuck. Their defense, for the most part, is pretty solid.
Yeah.
You know, it's pretty strong. Up front, you've got some really interesting pieces. I think it was key to get Cole Perfetti signed as a restricted free agent because, you know, maybe unlike the opportunity that he didn't have under Rick Bowness, who, you know, veteran coach, he was just flat out pedal to the metal. You know, you're not playing the way I need you to play. We're winning, or I'm going down swinging. And then, you know, ultimately he went down swinging. I think Perfetti in the top six is going to help a lot. And I know he's very popular in that room. So I think, honestly, I think Winnipeg's going to be better than you expect. I looked at that Central Division. Yeah. I mean, I think Dallas is going to be lights out good. Colorado is always a mystery to me, but I always wage on the upside of Colorado because of the talent. But I could see that division finishing at least in the top three. Very similar this year to where it was last year. Dallas, Winnipeg, and I think Colorado was third. Now, we haven't talked about Nashville, and Nashville is a team that's on the upswing.
Turnaround. Oh, yeah.
Like, crazy turnaround. Like, Barry Trotz, you know, is basically a rookie general manager, man. Talk about coming out swinging.
Absolutely. Like,
Marchessault and Stamkos and all that. So, he's betting on experience, but, you know, we'll see. I still like Winnipeg in that 2-3 hole for sure.
And see, what I like about Winnipeg, Jags, is the fact that they got Hellebuck. He's one of the best goalies in the NHL.
I think,
especially on top of his game, right?
Yeah, I mean, not underrated, but he's just always good.
Always good.
I feel like no one gives enough credit, but like they give him enough. If that makes sense, like he's really good, but he's just Hellebuck.
But you know what, fellas, and you guys probably know people who are like this, and it doesn't matter if you're a pro, amateur, whatever you are as an athlete, when you're comfortable in your environment, then you're probably going to do well. You're going to excel. And maybe you don't have to command top of the food chain financially. And that's what Connor Hellebuck is doing. Like right. Connor Hellebuck at $8.5 million on an annual average salary. Like it's bonkers compared to what we're seeing. You know, what's Jeremy Swayman after? You know, we can see what Sorokin has got. We can hear and read what Igor Shesterkin wants. Like, so that's where it starts in Winnipeg. For sure, that's where it starts. I mean, he gives you a chance to win every night.
Okay.
Well, down to you just brought miles. Up Swayman.
Oh, hold on, Torrie. We're getting there. That's in the other. We're going.
Trust me. I think all three of us.
Yes. And we waited for Torrie to get back because his team is the.
I'm sorry. I had to tuck my girls in.
That's okay. We waited for you. I told Dre to tell a long story about how cool Torrie is.
Yeah.
The Maple Leafs. New coach. Same result. Or do we see a change finally in Maple Leaf land?
Well, not just new coach, right? Like, so you have new coach. You have a new captain. Yeah. They change their blue line, I would say, substantially. They bring in Chris Danoff and Oliver Ekman-Larsson. Like, they've got some pieces that matter. They bring in Anthony Stolarz, who's their number two goalie. And I'm not convinced he's their number two. I mean, you need to see Joseph Woll healthy again and playing, and he hasn't played. But anyway, their goaltending stable looks good because you've got a healthy Matt Murray in that group too, and Hadelby has been terrific. Anyway, I mean, I think Toronto is better. Now, it's a different philosophy too, right? And Craig Berube is a meat and potatoes coach, and I love it. I'm there all day for it. Like, okay, boys, we're going to grind. You're going to play hard as you can absolutely play in training camp. Which is why we've seen some absences in the preseason. Some things are non-negotiable. We talked about Travis Green in Ottawa. Similarly for Berube, coverage in the defensive zone, which sounds ridiculous to say at the NHL level. You would think that that would just be commonplace. It's not. So, you know, he's going to be absolutely in lockstep with that. So I do feel like there'll be some growing pains, but in the long run, and long run meaning the playoffs, I think there'll be a team that's, as long as they're healthy, there'll be a team that's ready to contend for the East.
Torrie, any questions about your team before I go to the next two teams here?
No, I just I like to play fantasy GM with the Leafs.
Okay.
So I've got a million trades in my head, but no, I think the back end still needs improvement. And I don't want to bury you and ask you about any specific players, but there is one top D-man with them that I wouldn't hate seeing leave for something else, but just think he's overrated. I'm not going to name names.
Who is it?
Riley.
Yeah.
He does nothing for me. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Well,
are you kidding me?
I'm not going to agree with what you've said, but what I would admit to and say is you're not alone in your belief that there might be more out there, but I think that comes with the territory of being a top player in a media starved market, right? Like, I mean, he makes a mistake and everybody knows about it. He's actually been treated very fairly by Toronto media and by guys like you, Toronto Maple Leafs fans, I guess. I think though all bets are off this year. We just talked about, you know, what the changes might mean. So if Toronto loses in the first or second round of the playoffs, all bets are off. And it's not going to be Craig Berube or Brad Treliving. It is going to be the core of that roster that gets dinged, and maybe Riley, excuse me, is part of that. Could be.
Like you said, Berube's.
I was just going to say, like, everyone shits on Riley, and I think he plays 30 minutes a night. I'd have to watch him play for 3.5 years in the Western League. I played against him. He's unbelievable.
Tremendous.
He makes an awkward play in the playoffs last year and it scored up. No one talks about Yakimchuk walking Jake McCabe.
Yeah.
Like, Jake McCabe looked like he shouldn't be on the team anymore. I'm just
an
example. But, like, Morton Riley plays 30 minutes a night, answers the media every night. He's probably at every team function at every, that's my opinion. I go to bat for guys of that because they play the most, they answer the media, and they work their nuts off night in, night out.
Yep.
But I agree.
I'm not trying to shit on him. I'm just saying he doesn't do a lot for me. Not. That's all.
And look at and you're right. We're not piling on Morgan Riley. What I would admit to is when you're talking about Mitch Marner, when you're talking about prior to Nylander signing his extension, right, that core, well, he's in that core. So if, you know, again, if we're having this conversation a year from now and the Maple Leafs have had the same level of playoff success, which is zero, why like it's entirely fair.
Yeah.
Like, we're not saying he's a terrible hockey player. We're just saying that in a core that isn't winning, which he is a big part of, then, you know, he has to be considered as part of the problem.
I'm in the business. I get it with trading and whatnot, but I will say that he gets shit on a lot for minor mistakes. But I've always said this too, though.
Yeah.
Maybe I'm crazy. I've always wished, I thought I heard rumors last year of possibly happening. I wish John Gibson and Cam Fowler went to the Leafs. John Gibson, Tandy, Cam Fowler, 2 years ago. Yeah. Or am I crazy?
And what are you, like, how, like, you're just imploding their salary cap? Like, how are you making that work?
I think it'd be great to have those two pieces. Obviously, yeah, salary cap would be an issue. But, I mean, I just think those two types of players, obviously, one's a goalie and one's a D-man. But, you know, one's a steady top four guy and one's a starter. But I feel like, you know, obviously, you're right with the salary cap.
Well, and look, I mean, the Gibson rumors have been out there, not to Toronto, just across the board for the last couple of years. And I get it. And in fairness to John, it does feel like he's turned his game around a little bit, you know, in the last year or two. But it wasn't that long ago that most people thought he was really on the downtrend.
Right.
You know, it's interesting with Cam Fowler. He's 32 years of age. So what does he have? 2 years left on his contract. Maybe this year plus one more, I think. And Radko Gudas gets the captaincy of the Anaheim Ducks. And automatically my radar went up because I know Paul Maurice raves about Radko Gudas. There isn't a coach that has coached Radko Gudas, doesn't think he's a hell of a character guy. I understand that. It's not an indictment on Radko Gudas, but I'm wondering what the heck, like Cam Fowler has been through thick and thin. And it just seems like this is Pat Verbeek, the general manager, going, no, I'm going to keep my powder dry. Might have to trade this guy, and it's easier to, you know, deal with it and deal with all the nonsense if he's not the captain. That's the way I read it. So we'll see how it plays.
That's fair. No,
Allen Gibson for Marner.
Done.
You heard it here first.
Who says no? I can tell you who says no. Toronto.
Good. That's for the cap. No.
Two teams left. Troy's patiently waiting, and of course they're going to be
come laughing. On, Troy, bring it.
They were in the Cup final, but we're going to go to Vancouver quickly. I know you mentioned earlier, you touched on it. As good as last year, or worse, or just kind of the same?
Well, look, I'm a big believer in Rick Tocchet. I you know, for me, that's where it starts. And that's not bearing Bruce Boudreau, but I took a lot of heat in covering that whole saga with Boudreau and then ultimately the hiring of Rick Tocchet and trying to explain to the masses out there who are Boudreau believers. And I get it. He's a very popular guy. But I understood management's position as to why they wanted to make the change, when they made the change, and leading up to why they made the change. And when, you know, you look at even Ottawa and what we expect. We talked about Ottawa earlier in the segment. And another reason why I believe in Ottawa is because of Travis Green, right? Travis Green is an excellent players coach. He is fair, but he's firm. And that's exactly what Rick Tocchet is. And Travis Green has his fingerprints all over the Vancouver Canucks, you know, dealing with them in the American League and then shepherding those guys into the NHL. And then he got dispatched. And look, I mean, Tocchet and his staff, you know, Adam Foote, they're like, these guys are tremendous coaches. So for me, that's where it starts. And now you look at some of the ads. DeBrusk always seemed like he was looking for something in Boston. I don't know if you guys read it the same way.
Yeah.
Like there were stretches where I would watch this kid play in Boston and I go, oh my God, like this guy is just, he's perfect. He's a perfect Boston Bruin. Yep. And then all of a sudden he'd disappear for 10 games and you go, what the hell happened? And, you know, I mean, I'm a big fan of Louis. So, I mean, the apple doesn't fall far from the trees. So now you look at coaching and all this. So in a long-winded way, I do think that the ads that they made in Vancouver are going to help. But to get them to a higher level and not go back, they need the primary pieces. And that starts with Patterson, right? Like he's got to be the horse. He has to be the horse. It can't always be night in and night out about Besser and about JT Miller and some of the other guys. This guy has got to lead every single night. And if he does, then I think they're going to be fine. If he doesn't, maybe they do take a bit of a step back, especially if we go back to earlier what we said about goaltending.
I love it. Okay. Seventh and final. Cup finalists. Troy, take it away.
I'm going to take a nap here.
We haven't even started the season, fellas. Okay, Drakes. What's going to happen with Oilers? Are they going to the Cup again this year?
Yeah, I mean, that's a tall ask. Have you guys seen the Amazon series yet? Like the behind the scenes? No. All right. Well, I haven't seen it.
Only the clips.
Okay, yeah, is this the one where Connor went off on him in game?
Yeah, they put out snippets, right? Like one was
Chuck David.
Yeah.
That was a cool one, too. Yeah. That was cool.
Yeah.
Wait, what's it called? I'm sorry to interrupt.
I don't know what it's not even out yet. Like the whole series will be out.
Okay. Yeah.
But I'm telling you, like I've seen more than snippets. I haven't seen the entire series, but, and this pains me to say, not because of you know, just anointing the king of kings in the hockey world. Connor McDavid is the best player we've seen. Like physically, he's the best player. And boy, is that saying a lot. When you look historically at Gretz and you look at, go down the list, Mario Lemieux, if healthy, who knows?
EVY, Joe Sakic.
Yeah, I mean, go down. Gordie Howe, yeah. Bobby Orr revolutionized his. I mean, it's we're just talking about a completely different era and different way the game is played. But he is most. So what I'm seeing from what I've already witnessed from this series is a different level of emotional commitment from an athlete than I've seen from this person. And you know what? To me, that stuff matters, right? Like, it doesn't matter the sport, right? When you pull the curtain away and you see the best in the sport, win or lose, show you something that you didn't know that they actually had, or maybe, you know, of course, they lose game 7 in Florida. They're pissed off. Like, they're not sitting there. Like, I was sitting in the press box in Florida when that happened, and Gary Bettman announces that Connor McDavid, as a loser, has won the Conn Smythe. And everybody around me is like, well, he's not coming out. I'm like, who would come out? Like, what is wrong with it? Why are we even asking this question? Why should he come out? He's where he should be.
With
his
group.
He's with his teammates. Yep. What does it take to be a superstar in any major sport? And it goes beyond what happens in the arena, on the field of play, on the ice. And I don't know Connor that well. I've interviewed him a bunch of times, all of that. What I've seen behind the curtain of this series raises his stardom for me significantly. Like, so...
Yeah.
Whether they get back to the Stanley Cup final this year, fellas, I don't know. I don't have a crystal ball. Do I think that they're getting back with Connor McDavid? Yeah. Do I think they're going to win with Connor McDavid? I do.
So, I mean, Draisaitl re-signs huge contracts. So he obviously wants to be there. I mean, sorry, I could talk Oilers hockey for like 4 or 5 hours with if you wanted to, Drakes, but we only have a certain amount of time. goaltending. Stewie, I still think he's a legit number one. I mean, I still think they need a 1B. I know they're running with Pickard, who just got hurt.
Yeah.
Defensively, I wasn't happy with some of the moves they made in the offseason. He was popping up on forwards more often. And then they just let go of Mike Hoffman, who I thought would have been a really good addition on the fourth line. Corey Perry, who's pushing my age, 43 now, right? I'm not too sure.
Hoffman's not a fourth line guy. Sorry. Go on.
Yeah. He's not right there. Yeah.
He's a top six guy.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. Those Hoffman should have been playing for the Oilers.
Nah.
Right?
But no, not sold, but keep going. Yeah.
But Hoffman's not a bottom six guy.
No.
Like, he's a pure goal scorer. He's got to play in top six.
Or he has to be. And if he's not, and he wouldn't have been on that team.
Right.
You know, you
it take just shows me team. Some of the other contracts we've signed with the Oilers over the
past few years. But like, you know what?
Getting on that team.
I get it, but that's, you know, when you're a cap team and you're shelling out the money that they're going to have to continue to shell out. Like,
right.
Yeah. So now it's Leon Draisaitl, which kicks in next year. You know, then you've got Bush's radar on. Like, what do we think that Evan Bouchard is going to make? Right.
Well, he's going to get 8.5.
No, keep going. Come on.
I said at least
10. Oh, yeah. He'll be 10 million.
You think he's a $10 million? Oh, my gosh.
Well, let's see what the year is. But so, you know, again, when you look at their blue line, you know, you're relying on three primary targets there, right? I mean, that and that's assuming that Darnell Nurse, and I'm willing to give Darnell the benefit of the doubt, because how do we know how much of the year last year he played unhealthy? We know right. We played the playoffs hurt, right? And even now he's not healthy. So if he can get close to being the guy he was when he earned that contract, all right, now you got him, you've got Bush, you've got Ekholm, you've got some other pieces that you can work with. But I
got to ask you, Darren, what do you think about the Oilers and St. Louis?
What's that?
It's hilarious. What with the Oilers and St. Louis with Broberg and
The offer sheets.
Did that not just put St. Louis behind the eight ball, in my opinion?
No. I mean, it will if those players don't pan out. I mean, that's the risk and the gamble that you take when you're a team like Edmonton, where you have zero wiggle room. It's not like Ken Holland didn't know that those guys were, you know, potentially vulnerable to offer sheets. But you're trying to manage your current situation, and then on top of that, you're trying to manage a future. The one that was more interesting than Holloway to me was Broberg, because there'd been so many rumblings around Broberg. He wants out. He wants this. He doesn't like, you know, and he just didn't seem to be a fit in Edmonton. And then he gets a taste late in the year and this guy looks like he's an NHL defenseman. And the next thing you know, he's on an offer sheet and he's out the door. So
I just think he got way more money than the Oilers would have ever paid him, in my opinion, in the first couple of years.
For sure he did.
Right? That contract could really, really, really hurt St. Louis in a couple of years if he doesn't pan out.
You're right. But I guess from St. Louis' perspective, you're looking at a transition. You're not looking at a rebuild in Edmonton. So you're hoping they're getting two motivated guys who are getting paid but affordably, that they've got a bit of NHL experience that they can augment whatever you've got, you know, in Kyrou and Thomas and some of the other pieces that they already have. So I thought it was an aggressive move by the St. Louis Blues, but I understood why they did it, because Edmonton was vulnerable, and I'm surprised that more teams don't do it, because players like that are available every single year.
So my last question regarding the Oilers, sorry, Torrie, and I'll cut it off with the Oilers because I know we've got more show to do. Evander Kane's going to be on LTIR, right? I think that's been announced already.
With
him going to LTIR, the offer sheets from St. Louis, I believe that's going to open up a lot of wiggle room come trade time.
Yeah.
Who, I know you don't have a crystal ball, but what or who could you see the Oilers going after that could be a potential free agent?
Cam Fowler.
Well, yeah, maybe. I mean, maybe. You know, it's impossible to say, because you're at a point now in the year where they're still assessing what they have internally. And that includes some of their younger draft guys who, you know, are going to go back to their feeder systems, be it the American League or whatnot. And you also, aside from Evander Kane, don't really have an injury need, right? So I think they're happy with starting the year as they are. seeing what they have, and then moving forward beyond that. It feels to me that their most pressing need is likely going to be on defense. That's what makes the most sense to me. But, you know, all of a sudden somebody gets hurt up front or one of the goalies goes down and you have a completely different scenario on your hands.
Okay. 17, Torrie, go on quickly here.
Oh, sorry. I was just going to ask real quick. Do you see the whole offer sheet thing happening more and more frequently now? I feel like that kind of proved you can just do it when you find a team that's vulnerable cap wise.
Yeah.
And, you know,
yeah.
Like, I heard Doug Armstrong on a podcast saying it's like, it's nothing personal. It's just, we had a need. They had, you know, cap issues. So it just worked.
Yeah. And I mean, Doug isn't right very often, but in this case, he is. You know, it's
shots fired.
I mean, I don't know. He unfollowed me a long time ago for whatever reason. And thought he and I were buddies back in the day, but apparently not. So he's good in retirement. And every once in a while, he's like a turtle. He pops his head out of the sand and away we go. But I would say, look, I mean, Doug is 100% right. Like, the system is there to be used, and it is actually surprising that more teams don't take advantage of it. But I can give you a flip side scenario. Like, I'm sure the agents for Cole Perfetti, as an example, felt like, oh my God, this kid is a primary target for an offer sheet. Like, somebody give him the $4+ million and force Winnipeg to match or what? So Winnipeg matches, and all you've done is piss off a general manager and a team and an ownership group. So in Edmonton's case, they put themselves in a real vulnerable spot with both those guys. They did. And it's not like they had to give up on both. They could have matched on one and let the other one go. Right. And, you know, they decided that now, you know, we'll take cap flexibility instead. So that's the issue. I wish more teams would do it because I think it's good for the game. It's good for the player. It's fun to talk about. It's within the rules. But, you know, general managers, most of them are old cronies too, right? Like, they don't want to get on the bad side of each other.
That's business, Drage. And you love it.
Yeah.
Obviously, it portrays your business. But, like, anyone that isn't actually a fan of a team, Troy, Torrie, for me, it's like, let's go. You know, I want to hear this. I want to hear the offer sheets. Like, absolutely. It's a no-brainer.
Rollo Golf, presenting sponsor of the Off the Hosel podcast. Reminder, at checkout, on all orders, Hosel 25, H-O-S-E-L 25, promo code for 25% off on all orders. Check out Rollo Golf today.
Okay, I'm going to say 14 to 16 minutes. I want to make sure we have Dregs on for the fourth time before he blocks us, probably. Just kidding. Okay, on other NHL news, I have about four or five topics, and then these you can hammer out quick. If these guys have one, great. Boston, Jeremy Swayman, contract, more thoughts on that one. That's my first one.
Yeah, well, I mean, we have to be careful time-wise with this one. It does feel like it's going to get done. I wouldn't say it's imminent, obviously. It seems, you know, the old cliche status quo. Weird that it got to this point from both sides. It's weird. And then more weird is how, you know, Cam Neely, who doesn't love Cam Neely, comes out publicly and says, wow, 64 million reasons. Like, and if I'm Louis Gross, who represents Jeremy Swayman, my public response would have been, if Boston puts a $64 million deal on the table, we will sign it in the next 4 minutes. Like, do it, you know, because I feel like that's where they're at. So,
right. But now there's trade talks now.
Yeah, kind of, not really. I mean, trade talks are somewhat superstitial because, you know, at the end of the day, Boston control this guy's rights. So, you know, who is giving the assets required for Boston to make that trade? Because I don't know, you guys watch Yunus Korpisalo last year? I know he's had a good camp. He wasn't good in Ottawa. He just was not good in Ottawa. So, you know, everybody is a boss, including Cam Neely and Don Sweeney, and that's the Jacobs family in Boston. They're cutthroat, absolutely cutthroat. So they might lose a couple of games, and all of a sudden the tone of that negotiation will change.
I think the best way before Torrie jumps in was, quote-unquote, Seabass said that.
Yeah.
All right, Torrie, go on.
Were you surprised his agent came out and posted that?
No.
Say it. No?
No, I wasn't, you know, because, like, I mean, that's kind of his job as representative of the player. And what does Jeremy Swayman have to gain by, you know, posting his own whatever, right? So, and I didn't think that anything that Lewis Gross said was inflammatory or whatever. I think he was taken aback, as was Jeremy, and just simply said, we're going to need some time to digest. But I don't know, man. At the end of the day, just get a deal done and get back in camp and get back playing. Because as good as Boston was for the first, two-thirds of the year last year, they didn't come close to achieving what they hoped they would. And that's a very demanding market. So they're going to struggle if they don't have quality goaltending.
Yeah, they're handcuffed right now with Olmark.
Yeah.
Okay, I have three more points, and if you guys have one, I'm going to rip them off, though. L.A. Kings, our friend of the show and good buddy of mine, Tanner Janot, now with the L.A. Kings. Playoffs, Doughty's hurt. Where are they at?
Yeah. Well, I give management there a ton of credit, because I remember Rob Blake a year ago, maybe a bit more, saying that he feels like he owes it to the leadership core there, and he's talking about Kopitar, and he's talking about Doughty, and he's talking about some of the other guys. And every year, one or more of those guys disappears. You know, it's Carter, and before that is Brown, and go down the list. So they're starting to run out of runway here, but in doing so, they're actually developing a real nice youth movement there. I watched Byfield play a lot of minor hockey in Ontario. I think they've done a great job of insulating. Yeah. Hold on a sec.
Bless you.
Of insulating this kid, and had to cough there, and getting him ready for what it means to be, you know, a top six NHL player. Right. Is their goaltending good enough? Probably. Defensively, without Drew Doughty, it's going to be painful for a bit, but I don't know. Again, go back to the Pacific. We talked about this earlier. I think they're going to be in that 3-4 spot.
Okay, I have two more, I think, important points. And then, like I said, Pittsburgh, after 2 years missing the playoffs, will this be the last run for them before the breakup of the core? Obviously, Sidney Crosby, you never rule out the team, and Crosby. Where's Pittsburgh at? They look good in the preseason so far. I've watched, but what do you think?
Yeah. I'm with you. I'm on the fence. That's what I think. Tristan Derry, you know, can he be as good as his goalie supporters believe he is?
Right.
I keep hearing Noodles, Jamie McLennan, talk about, you know, he's a good goalie. As long as he stays healthy, this, that, and the other. Okay, I'll buy it. Like, what the hell do I know about goaltending? I mean, you put a good defense in front of any goaltender and you're going to have a pretty good goalie. So I'm also not sold on the defense of the Penguins. How do you not like the game that Evgeny Malkin and Sidney Crosby had against Ottawa the other night? I mean, that was a pretty good Ottawa lineup. You know, Allmark wasn't in net, but okay, here's Evgeny Malkin with a hat trick and Sidney Crosby with a couple of goals. I mean,
what a barn!
If those horses can stay healthy and motivated, of course they have a chance, but there's a ton of work there for Kyle Dubas to do. And, I've talked to Kyle about this, not recently, but certainly going into the season, about how, you know, he thinks that their up-and-comers are better than most people think, right? Okay, well, if that's true, then I'm willing to give the leadership of the Penguins the outside chance. I am.
My last one is Detroit, after, I think, 7 or 8 years missing the playoffs. They were, I think, tied last year to get in, but worked on a tiebreaker, missed the playoffs. Are they able to push the needle enough to get back into the playoffs? Finally, the Eiser plan, they call it, are they still kind of just outside, but not quite there?
Well, I'm leaning to the camp of outside, not quite there. Because again, you look in the Eastern Conference, you know, if we agree that Ottawa is better and Ottawa is going to nibble or make the playoffs, then who's coming out of that equation?
Right.
Is New Jersey worse? No, they're not worse. They're better. And if they can stay healthy, they're going to be back into that equation. So then you throw Buffalo in on the mix. Now you got Detroit. And yeah, Detroit is interesting to me, and I don't want to bet against anyone, especially before they drop puck on the start of the regular season. I just don't see enough yet in the Detroit Red Wings to balance off of what I'm seeing in Ottawa and what I think the New Jersey Devils are going to do. So I'm guessing they're not going to make it.
Boys, that's my NHL others. If you guys have any more, by all means, ask Dreg before he hangs up on us.
Who won the offseason?
Who won the offseason?
Good question.
Ooh, that is a good question.
I got a team in mind. I've got their jersey.
Like, I'm trying to think of the, like, I mean, it's all very subjective. I mean, every team that added a free agent maybe felt like they won the offseason. I mean,
Nashville's probably in the discussion.
I mean, up there.
That would be the jersey right there.
It would be, well, but I mentioned New Jersey as a team that's definitely, yeah. So, you know, I got into a bit of heat about this last week when I said, you know, I mentioned that New Jersey, you know, was in trade discussions with Winnipeg prior to Connor Hellebuyck signing his extension and didn't pull the trigger. And one of the reasons was they were scared of what that contract extension would look like. Well, at 8.5, I mean, Connor Hellebuyck looks like a pretty good deal.
Yeah.
And then goaltending was one of the reasons, among others, that New Jersey just couldn't compete last year. And now that they have, Jacob Markstrom, you know, trade that we never thought was going to happen because we talked about it every day of the week for about 5 months, finally happened. I might put New Jersey in that conversation. I might.
New coach, okay. Too.
What's that? New coach, yeah. Here,
yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Who's a good coach, by the way? You know, he, like, if Sheldon Keefe didn't believe that he had a chance to win, and had the security that he obviously has in New Jersey, he wouldn't have dove back. He kind of got lit up here a little bit in Toronto because, you know, he said that he wanted to step away and focus on his family and all that. But again, we're all
right.
Involved in sport in some capacity, and, you know, we're not idiots. If somebody presents, you know, not just a financial offer to you that you can't turn away from, but an opportunity to win, well, that's how everybody's wired in pro sport. So I think Sheldon, in his second job as an NHL head coach, I think he's going to help the New Jersey Devils. I do.
Troy, any last thoughts?
Yeah, I got four rapid fires, like real quick.
All right,
one, bring Driggs, it. Stanley Cup champion, 2025.
Edmonton.
125 points over under Connor McDavid.
Over.
Johnny Gaudreau, any comments?
One of the most likable athletes that I've ever had the privilege of interviewing and getting to know.
And just to make it nice and easy, favorite ice cream.
Look at me. I'm like a temple. Like, I got to think about this. Neapolitan.
Oh, I like it.
That was my favorite when I was a kid. I got one quick hitter.
Okay.
And you don't have to name the team. Do you have a favorite team?
I don't. But.
Oh, you know, quit.
And it's only because I have so many favorite people that
right.
Spread across the National Hockey League. So would I like to see Winnipeg win for personal reasons? Yeah. Paul Maurice, very good friend of mine. Couldn't have been happier for the Florida Panthers to win the Stanley Cup last year and go down the list. So no, I don't.
I know how you answer that, Darren. You just say Estevan Bruins.
Yeah. Well, Dre, hey,
one of my favorite people of all time, God rest his soul, Daryl McDonnell, is an alumni of the Estevan Bruins. He might have been back in the day, and I got to think about this. I think I better not screw this up. You better fact check me on this. He would have been one of the toughest dudes to ever play in the SJHL, and I'm not joking.
How do you spell it? Darren Mac?
No, Daryl and Mac Donnell. So now you got me on the spot. I want to say MCDONNELL. Daryl was he's a toughest. I grew up in Langeberg, Saskatchewan, the home of the Mac Donnell clan. I mean, we call him McDonald, and then it got twisted to Mac Donnell somehow. But I'm telling you.
I'll have to find that
out. Don't have it?
I got
the exact same results you just did.
I'm going to find it, boys. You don't know.
I want you to find that. But also, Dregs, on this, my last rapid fire is, like we're going to golf this summer, no? That was just a joke earlier, right?
What's that?
Like, that was a joke earlier. Like, we're going to golf this summer, no?
Where?
I'll come again.
You guys are drunk here. So, 1980-81. Daryl Mac Donnell played 19 games with the Estevan Bruins. No, sorry. He had 19 goals, 12 assists, 31 points, and 180 penalty minutes.
Okay, how do you spell his last name? M-A-C?
M-C-D-O-N-E-L-L. Daryl, D-A-R-Y-L.
So okay. While you're doing that, you got to look up our cousin Joey Koser in Sasky.
Oh, yeah, I don't need to look up Joey.
You know those stats, goals. Right?
Holy shit, 180 pims. Wow, shout out to Bruins, the team I coach.
So my son is 23 years of age, played a bit of hockey in his day, and I told him I was coming on this show, and I said, oh, true Koser. Okay, and he goes, wow, is this Saskatchewan pot? And I said, yeah. More or less, and he goes, is that Joe Kosher's relative? And I said, yeah, well, he's got to be. And so, and he goes, that guy threw bombs. Like he said, it's a 23-year-old kid. I'm like, what are you talking about? You have no idea what you're talking about. Arguably that one of the toughest in the National Hockey League, bar none, who I had the privilege of covering and watching play. He goes into my all-time Hall of Fame. I'm not kidding.
I'm not trying to kiss their ass, but I've heard so many podcasts where people are like, he threw through your head, at your head.
Yeah.
just
like hams. He had hams. Like they weren't even fists. Yeah, I know.
I like hearing the stories about their softball teams.
Oh, yeah. Oh, God. That's quite a team. Yeah. The one team especially. Like,
maybe Drewster will line up on with Joey and Drake. Get us all in one big
series. Yeah.
That's a good idea.
Anyway, Daryl, boys, sadly passed away of cancer a couple of years ago. The family is they're great friends of mine, and I know they'd be thrilled that we just had this quick conversation. But yeah, the Estevan Bruins will always be part of my heart, only because of a couple of players, but certainly Daryl.
And is that coach there, right, Drake? And is that coach?
What's that?
And is that coach there, right? So there's three.
Yeah,
now. Perfect.
Oh, okay. We'll throw you into the mix.
Okay. Episode 161, Darren Dreger, three-timer, not a big deal. We appreciate it, Dregsy. Come on again. We hope we do it again. Thanks for NHL tee up to the 24-25 season. Thanks so much, Dregsy.
All right, boys, be well.
Well, we hope you enjoyed the episode. Quick reminder and thank you to our sponsors, presenting sponsor Roll of Golf at checkout, Hosel 25 on all orders purchased. That's Hosel 25 at Roll of Golf. Thanks to TaylorMade Golf. The Tower Tap House 1124 in Estevan, Saskatchewan, and our pre-show sponsor, Remax and Jeff Will. We'll talk to you all next week.